Hi, everyone. I'm Pauline Thornhill. Thanks for joining us. This week on Land and Sea, we have a story about the coastal boats. 150 years ago, the government of the day started the coastal boat service. The boats brought mail and freight to the island's many isolated fishing villages. Well, some things never change. As producer Fred Greening will show you, there are still a few isolated villages left, and their way of transportation is like something from another time.
She spent nearly 40 years taking passengers and mail and freight to the villages around Newfoundland and Labrador, and she spent the last 40 years on the rocks in Harbor Grace. Grass growing out of her deck, her pride and dignity in tatters. She's the last of the Newfoundland steamships.
It's a great pity that she just left over there to rust and rot and, you know.
Varick Cox has built about 50 model ships. Now he's building the Kyle.
I remember going out, I was fishing out of St. John's, you know, on Small Point Ledge, and it was a beautiful day, and a nice big swell on. And then I remember the Kyle passed by no more than about 25 feet away from me, and she was going into the water, you know, and our propeller was turned. It was hardly any sound, only when the wave from a bow wave, you know. So it was a beautiful sight. I've always loved the Kyle, and she fascinated me, and I'd like to build a model of her, and that would do a bit of justice, you know, and would last forever. People could look at this 100 years' time, you know, and say, look, that was the Kyle, you know. And this one here is all copper and brass, so it's going to last a long time.
The Newfoundland government ran the entire transportation service before joining Canada, and this 1939 brochure proudly promotes their summer cruises to Labrador. The Kyle was in her prime. So was her purser, Victor Abbott.
I was on the Kyle, yeah. Yeah. I was on the Kyle with Captain Tom Connors and Captain Jimmy Snow.
His hearing is bad, but his memory is sharp, very sharp, for someone 97.
I wasn't permanent on there. I spent most of the time on the Glencoe and the Northern Ranger and the Bacalhau. Yeah.
And you were the purser and the wireless operator.
Yeah, yeah. But the Kyle, she was a good ship. She carried about 300 passengers, second class and first class.
The vessels changed from steamers like the Kyle to ships with diesel engines like the Nonia. What didn't change was the routine on the wharf. There was a time, and less than 50 years ago, when there were no roads in or out of most of the communities around Newfoundland and Labrador. This was their lifeline to the outside world. The wharf was like the community center. People gathered here to see who was coming, who was going, to see if their package had arrived from some faraway place. Fast forward to the summer of 2006. Today's coastal boat service is a pale imitation of its former self. Roads have been punched into nearly all the outports, but there are still a few isolated settlements where their way of getting in and out is still wedded to the past. This is La Poyle on Newfoundland's south coast. The arrival of the coastal boat still acts like a magnet, drawing people to the wharf. For some, it's more of a necessity than a curiosity. Now there's no wharfinger to handle the freight. If you order something in, you're responsible for picking it up. At this stage in its life, and its population down to 100 people, it's a safe bet that people in Lapoille will never drive cars and trucks to the outside world. Their highway will continue to be the sea. Most Newfoundland communities are having a tough time hanging on to their people. Isolated fishing towns like Lapoille have a bigger challenge. Yvonne Organ runs the town's post office.
Well, let me ask you this question. Does the community have a future? Tough question?
Yes, that is a very tough question. I remain optimistic. A lot of people say it's only a matter of time, and I do agree. I agree to that. Financially, you know, if you got to make that move, you got to make a move, as so many other people have done. It's starting to feel more lonesome. Like the past winter, it was really, really lonesome here. There are more men going out west to work, and you know, it's just like an emptiness, and it's just so quiet, and there's very little activity going on. So it's kind of sad, but I say if we're here in 20 years' time, I say, wow, we made another 20 years. But if we're not here, I would say I'm not surprised.
Governments began delivering mail and freight to Newfoundland outports 150 years ago. The type of vessel has gone through several transformations, from sail to steamer to the larger diesel-driven ships run by Canadian National. In the 1960s, here on the south coast of Newfoundland, the coastal boat would visit no fewer than 45 outports during a weekly trip. Now the number of isolated towns in the area is down to 8. On this beautiful summer's morning, we're in the town of Grand Brit, population 32. This boat has another stop further east in Burgio, so it's a quick turnaround here. There are empty gasoline drums to be taken back and refilled, an absolute necessity in a village of fishermen. There are empty beer bottles to be carried back and refilled. Well, not an absolute necessity, but for many, certainly a treat. Watching that boat pull away and with no road connection to the outside world, a first-time visitor gets the sense they're witnessing something so out of time. The sense of isolation becomes immediate. But isolation is not all bad. Grand Brit is one of those best-kept secrets.
I was a policeman in Toronto for the past 40 years of my life.
Brad Dillon came to Grand Brit for a vacation and bought a house.
This is great. This is like freedom. So you can't beat this. Like, if you're anywhere else, you'd have to buy this. You'd have to pay for this, you know. This is great. I hope it never changes. Never.
But it will change, as surely as change itself is inevitable. In the mid-1960s, coastal boats had to anchor offshore at some South Coast communities. There were no wharves where they could dock. Men came out in small boats to pick up supplies. Back then, the fishery was good. The fathers weren't gone to Western Canada to get jobs, and there were lots of children.
So that's what builds up to the climax in that subplot. Okay, what bad things happen on the same page there, page 44? Mike talks about three things that happen the next week.
No longer are there lots of school children in these communities. In Grand Britt, there are two. On this day, one is sick, half the student population in the entire school. Here, you don't have to work hard to get the teacher's attention.
Do you miss interaction with more children? Or?
No. No. No.
This works nicely for you.
Yeah.
What do you want to do after you finish school? Any
welding.
Idea?
Welding. That'll be my main interest.
So I guess you'll obviously, like other children in the community, you'll go away to work.
Fort McMurray, out in different places.
That's where the jobs are.
That's where the big money is at.
I see the Grand Brittle.
Cynthia Billard came here from Nova Scotia 23 years ago, fell in love with the fishermen, and fell in love with Grand Brit.
With a community of 32 people, how do you see the future?
Well, I mean, nobody can predict what the future is going to bring, but I mean, all of our children are gone out. My son's gone away. I mean, there's no way he's coming back. My daughter will eventually go out, and she's not coming back. None of the other children that have gone from here since I've been here have come back to live, just to visit. And we have an aging population. And when you have no children in a community, your community is slowly going.
The romantics among us would question how such a postcard piece of real estate could ever be allowed to die. But the realists quickly point out you need money to survive. Money that's hard to come by in a fishery on life support.
Basically, you can't live on no money no matter where you're at. You got to have money to live. And the money comes from the fishing, and if the fishing's not there, eventually you will have to go somewhere else.
Canadian Naval Dockyard was up here, remember?
Yeah,
Canadian Naval Dockyard was up here on the south side.
Yeah.
And, of course, all the waterfront has changed.
Oh, yeah.
There's no comparison whatsoever. And, you know, then again, there's no comparison to the type of vessels around here either.
That's right. The vessels are all changed, and then the wharves are all changed.
So it's from what it was 50 years ago, it's amazing.
And the vessels. Between them, they had 60 years as skippers on the coastal boats. Today in retirement, they survey St. John's Harbor and trade in old sea yarns. Captain Joe Prim, Captain Joby Kane. Kane spent 10 years as captain of the Norma and Gladys, a converted sailing schooner his dad bought in the 1950s as a private business, running freight up and down the northeast coast.
We carried milk, butter, and sugar. Well, everything a person needs in a home, or the merchants down there used to stock it up, we'd carry it. And oil, gasoline for the motorboats, fuel oil kerosene oil for their lamps and that. We carry all that.
The private boats tied up at private wharves, usually owned by the local merchants. The government wharf was meant for the government ship run by Sea and Marine. Some communities and harbors were too small for CN, more prime territory for smaller boats like the Norma and Gladys. But then came the 1960s, and the Canes and their boat became the victims of progress.
In 65, the roads ran through. All those small places, down St. Anthony and Cook's Harbor, all the beautiful freight we were getting then, that disappeared aboard the trucks. We had nothing.
So when the roads came in, that was the end of your business?
That was the end. I said, five. I came in St. John's one night. I almost cried. I said, Viola, it's all over. It's all over. We might as well admit it.
But there was lots of business for CN Marine. Their ships were still the only way of getting in and out of many isolated outports, and especially Labrador. Not only that, CN provided a cheap service. Freight and passengers were heavily subsidized by the federal government. Private operators like Joby Kane found it tough to compete with CN. He couldn't beat them, so he joined them.
In July, I got this job at the railway. Third mate on the cabin station. Now I was in with the government. The beautiful government. All that money that stacked up that they took from other people.
He worked on the CN ships for 25 years. For 20 of them, he was the captain.
What was your favorite run?
Labrador. I could have been up on the big ferries, you know, but I preferred Labrador, loved Labrador. I knew all the people down there, and I knew all the runs, where all the rocks were too.
Runs that I got the most satisfaction out of was the Labrador run. I liked it on the Labrador, and I liked the people down there, you know. And the people very rarely complained. Now, they only seen a vessel for a few months of the year, but they never complained. And they were great people. Where they had wharves, too, and you could dock, it wasn't too bad, you know. When they had to come out in boats, particularly when the weather was cold and stuff like that, you know, life was really miserable.
We captured one of those miserable moments as winter was closing in November of 1986. The captain was Joby Kane. Here's the CN vessel Bonavista off a tiny community on the coast of Labrador. There was no wharf for the ship to land, and there were people and freight to be picked up. It was like something out of the third world.
Oh, it was pretty rough. The dangerous too sometimes. But they had to do it, eh? There's no other way, you know.
50 years ago, there were nearly twice as many communities scattered around the island of Newfoundland. People settled in every cove and harbor, wherever the small fishing boats could find protection from the wind and the waves. Fishermen never had the technology to take their boats far out to sea. They had no choice but to settle close to where they were. Most of these coastal boat captains got their real education on the sea. They were more interested in being on the water than staying in school. But a formal education is never too late, even for old sea dogs like Joby Kane.
When I became 56 years old, 7 years before I retired, my daughters want me to go to university. And I said to them, I said, I can't get in university. I only got grade 9. You know, you can't get in university grade 9.
But he did get in. And he's been studying philosophy and anthropology and political science and literature for the past 20 years. At Memorial University in St. John's, you'll find Joby Kane there among the 19 and 20-year-olds doing exactly what his daughters wished for.
I got 19 credits now. I got to get another 21 credits. So at the rate I'm going now, be another 21 years.
So how old will you be then?
21 on 76. What's that?
97.
97. I'll be pushing up daisies long before that.
Victor Abbott is 97, and he's not pushing up daisies. He's still spinning yarns.
The sea can be very treacherous at times, and other times it can be peaceful. So it happened rough every time. I used to get seasick the other time.
And this senior citizen was built in 1913, which makes her 93. The only surviving Newfoundland steamship may be showing her age, but she can still sit upright. The torch has been passed to a new generation of coastal boats. They're smaller, and there's fewer of them, because there are fewer isolated towns. But as long as those towns can survive, one thing won't change. Their highway will always be the sea.